So in this next section, we'll be looking at IS to IS. Now, IS to IS stands for intermediate system to intermediate system. And according to ISO terminology, an intermediate system is a router. IS to IS means router to router routing protocol. It was developed in the late 1980s by the Digital Equipment Corporation and adopted in its entirety by ISO, the International Organization for Standards. ISO were developing a link state protocol for the CLNP protocol stack, which is the equivalent of IP, but they weren't actually developing it for IP. At this time, IP was thought of as more of a interim solution, so the OSI protocol stack was expected to take over and IP was expected to just fade away, but as we now know, that didn't happen. Those clever buds at the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force, they thought also that having a link state protocol was a good idea. A section of them went on to develop OSPF, and another section of them started working on IS to IS, making extensions for IP. And when they finished, this was called integrated IS to IS, and this is the IS to IS that we use nowadays. It has native support for IP version 4 and IP version 6 within the same stack. Unlike something like OSPF, if you look at OSPF version 2, that only supports IP version 4. If you wanted to support IP version 6, then you'd have to use a totally brand new protocol, which is OSPF version 3. Whereas with different TLVs, you could get that support natively within IS to IS. As we mentioned previously, IS to IS is a link state protocol, similar in operations to OSPF. Now, when we say a link state protocol, what we basically mean is that all the routers have a view of their entire area topology and a description of all the possible routes along with the associated costs. So what a router will do, it will build a link state database detailing all of the links within its local topology. Then it's going to place itself as the route of the tree and then use the SPF or the Dijkstra algorithm to find the shortest path to any given destination. In this way, the router is going to have a complete view of its local area topology, its local routing domain, from its own perspective. It doesn't need to rely on a neighbor's information because it has its own view of the topology. So moving on to IS to IS areas, we find that IS to IS supports a two-level hierarchy. The first one is level one only routers. Now, for a level one only router to form an adjacency, all its neighbors must have the same area ID. It won't form an adjacency with a neighbor that doesn't have the same area ID. And also, it's only going to be aware of its local area topology. Anything outside of its level, outside its area, it's not going to have a direct view of. Then we move on to level two only routers. They can form adjacency with neighbors that are in different areas, not a problem. And these level two routers are synonymous to OSPF backbone routers. Now, as far as I know, there's no vendors that actually have implemented the virtual link feature for IS to IS. So this means that if you had two level one areas at the end of a level two domain, that all the interim routers must be contiguous. It must be an unbroken chain of level two routers to provide end-to-end connectivity. These routers have routing information about inter-area routes. They will also have information about intra-area routes for the level two domain. Then we have level one, level two routers. These are synonymous to OSPF ABRs. And how they're going to actually communicate with the level one routers is that an L1, L2 router is going to identify itself to an L1 router by setting an attach bit. The L1 router will then send the default route to its closest, its nearest and dearest L1, L2 router to reach any route which is not within its local routing domain. The interesting thing about a level 1, level 2 router is that it's going to maintain both a level 1 and level 2 link state database. So if you just had two L1, L2 routers, they will have two separate link state database. They will form an L1 adjacency with the level 1, level 2 router, and a separate L2 adjacency with the level 1, level 2 router. This is a bit CPU intensive, so you find that a lot of ISPs will just have a flat level 2, no need for the level 1, just have a flat level 2 network, and it saves on CPU usage and avoids any complications. Now we're moving on to the IS-to-IS addressing schema. An IS-to-IS address is called a network service access point. Because you still have the underlying CLNS platform, all of the routers need to have a CLNS address, and this CLNS address is an NSAP address. An NSAP address is a bit different from what it would be in IP, because an NSAP address represents an entire router, not just a particular interface. So the entire router will have an NSAP address. And what you'll find is that within IP, a router needs to identify itself to other routers. This is called network entity title. And a network entity title, a NET address, is just an NSAP address with an N selector of 00. And what will happen is that this NSAP address, routers use this NET address similar to how OSPF will use a router ID to identify themselves to other routers in the IS-to-IS link state packets. We're going to look at the addressing format. So what happens is you have an AFI, which is a address family identifier. Now, if your IS-to-IS is running CLNS, you're going to have to approach ISO, for the CLNS address. If you're routing IP, then you'll find that many service providers just use 49. 49 is just like the 1918 private addresses, not routable across the internet, but it's locally significant. This 49 is just a number that you could choose because you're not routing CLNS anyway. It's not actually significant for routing, but it is significant for other routers to be able to identify the area. Then you actually move on to the area ID. This could be anything, as long if you're using level 1, then they have to be the same. If you're using level 2, then it can form an adjacency if the areas aren't the same. Then you have a 6-byte system ID, and then you'll find finally you'll have your N selector, which is 1 byte 00. So in regards to applying IS-to-IS to an actual router, there's a few steps that we go through. The initial step is that we would have to enable the IS-to-IS process globally. Then we would have to define the NET address. The reason why I've said an area address is because the system ID with some vendors is already pre-populated. Then we would enable the IS-to-IS process under the interface, or we could enable the interface under the IS-to-IS process. We would disable or enable the level that we required globally. Now you find that although a router is completely within an area, but the levels are defined under the interface. So we could also enable the required level per interface. If we enable the level globally, that would affect every single interface, but you can do it individually per interface.